my last lecture with everyone, and I'm very grateful for the fact that you've come to all of them, or at least from my point of view, it seems course grain or a big group, or it seems like group has always had something in it. So I'm very grateful for that. One thing that I wanted to say before I started talking about science, the staff occasionally feed us, of course, very anonymous form feedback that you provide about the lectures we're giving and how we're doing, and that's extremely helpful, so I'm very, very grateful to have it. One thing that I, a sense I maybe got was that some people at the summer school are completely on board and on the bandwagon and are just complexity zombies, and that's great, because I am as well. And that there are other people who may be feeling a bit sort of left off, and that they're not quite sure how much is going to stay with them when they go back to their home apartments, and how much use that's going to be. And so I had two sort of thoughts on this, actually. One thought was that when I was a graduate student, I was you, right? I was that person. I had a PhD that I really wanted to do. I wanted to do physics, and I was really uninterested in anything that didn't seem like it would be of use to me in writing my dissertation. And so now, of course, it's the opposite. Everything I thought was useless is now useful, so I understand that position. The second thing, I think this is really important, is if you're feeling skeptical about the utility of the things that I'm presenting, or someone else is presenting, or any subset of the lectures are presenting, if you're feeling skeptical about the utility of that, you are the most important person in the room at that point. And you might be able to find a way to ask that question constructively in the lecture itself, which is great. You may not be able to ask it constructively, which is also okay, do your best. But I think that what we can do as a group in the small amount of time we have left is test our ideas against each other. And for those of us who are really excited and are on, can see nothing wrong with what's going on the screen, that's a really nice place to be. But if you can test it against somebody who is really challenging, who says, I don't understand why this is useful, I don't understand what point this will have for me when I go back to my usual work, if you can talk to someone like that, it's extremely useful. And so I would just encourage you, if you are feeling a bit left out, to join in a way. And I think on the other side, if you're somebody who is totally loving everything that's going on and everything seems completely relevant, to be really open to people, other students in the school who are asking you questions that are challenging. Anyway, I'm sort of repeating myself, but I think it's a really useful thing that we can do, and it's one of the reasons we all come together as opposed to watching lectures on YouTube. Anyway, that's my small remark. We're going to talk about emergence today. I wanted to review just briefly a story, because it's come up a couple times, about the way we build scientific theories, and one of the ways in which I think emergence, coarse graining, effective theories are part of building scientific explanations. And just to review, you begin, I think, with a fine-grained theory, and the most familiar fine-grained theories to us, I think, in the school are agent-based models, where you have turtles, I forget what they're called in that logo, you have turtles that have ideas and emotions, they interact with each other, and you're interested in describing some large-scale phenomenon. And you can do that these days if you have a large enough machine. You can just build a fine-grained theory, calibrate it, hopefully, or even fit it if you don't even have calibration. Okay? So the large-scale data, make a prediction, tell a story, right? Show some emergent property just by looking at the screen. We have a larger set of goals. That's part of, I think, building a theory. If you can't get this step to work, if the net logo simulation is not working, okay, it may be because your underlying assumptions are wrong. Okay? It may be because it's required to code, that's a different question, right? But if this doesn't work, okay, something is wrong. But at the same time, when you come to build scientific theories that we can communicate to others, I think you have another step, which is go from a fine-grained theory, coarse-grained, to an effective theory. Okay? And again, I'm going to try, even though our discussion of emergence today will be very different from the way we talked about it yesterday, I think there's still this fundamental picture of how we go about doing science, I think. Yes, David?
So you kind of simulation as a long path from small-scale measurements to full prediction, but you really view it as completely separate from the building and as being separate from the effect of effective field theory, or was simulation as a essentially a mechanism to kind of head in that direction as well?
I think practically when you're doing science like in your room, I think you can do both, at least I do.
Okay.
And certainly our computers are fast enough that you can be a theorist and also learn enough coding to actually simulate. That used to not be the case, right? In order to build a simulation, you had to know Fortran and use punch cards. And if you did that, you didn't have time to do mathematics. And now I think actually it's wonderful we can do both. And so that's one of the wonderful things that's happened with the invention of things like Python and languages that are easier to write in and easier to see the results of quickly. So let me give you another definition of emergence. A system has emergent properties when an effective theory of the system at some scale or level of organization is qualitatively different from the lower level theory. Okay? And so these are some of the keywords that you saw before. There were some arguments that we tried to make about, for example, whether or not the aggregate behavior of people editing Wikipedia can or cannot be expected based upon the individual properties of the agents. We talked about whether, for example, the amalgamation of finite state machines might lead to a totally different non-finite state machine process at the higher level. Okay? So this is, I think, a working definition that's somewhat more quantitative than our intuitive sense that social processes, for example, going to the grocery store and being able to buy, you know, a bag of rice from India, somehow that's a compelling emergent property of the economy. Okay, that's kind of a flaky way to say it. I think this is slightly more quantitative. Today we're going to talk about a particular instantiation, or at least one that I think instantiates that statement, and that's the phenomenon of symmetry breaking. Okay? So we're going to cash out this statement here. The effective theory has qualitatively different properties from the lower level theory as the following. Okay? The higher level theory violates a symmetry of the lower level theory. Okay? It breaks, there's some symmetry in the underlying theory, and exactly what that means we'll talk about in detail. Okay? But there's some property in this case, the symmetry of the lower level theory, the individuals. Okay, it's violated when you aggregate, when you join copies that are interacting together. Okay. So this is a list of topics, but hopefully I'll be clear enough that we not need this guide. These are the essential concepts from yesterday, coarse grain, effective theory, and base and retraction. Base and retraction being which groups of mechanisms, okay, coarse grain to the same large-scale effective theory. And I'll show the diagram again, but you remember, for example, the claim was made that at least in some limits, when you're concerned with certain properties, okay, the learning of human languages and the learning of computer languages is the same. They coarse grain to the same large-scale statistical properties. Okay? And that's unusual. We even saw, for example, the Spanish Civil War also coarse grain to that same logarithmic class. Here are the essential concepts for today. Okay, there's three. Okay? Ordered parameter, control parameter, and critical line, critical point. Okay. So the ordered parameter, and I'll try not to read directly from my slide, but an ordered parameter is something that you define in your low-level theory, the theory about the individual constituents. Okay. So oftentimes we just think of it as a number. It might be a number. It might be a vector. Okay. So for example, it might be a vector describing your preferences. So you have preferences over three kinds of outcomes, okay? And in my internal mental space, right, I have a little vector that points in some three-dimensional direction, okay? And all these components go from one to one. Okay? So that's an example of an ordered parameter, okay? Generally, the ordered parameter is the thing that's going to have the symmetry, okay? So, for example, if I have a vector of preferences, right, A, B, or C, before I tell you what A, B, or C are, okay, you don't really have any preference. Okay? So your vector could just as well point here as point there. Okay. So the symmetry is in some sense an ignorance or a not caring about the value for some property of a quantity. Okay? So that's the order parameter. So I gave two examples here. The IC model, which you know from Moore's lectures, okay? The order parameter is plus one or minus one, the internal state of the object. Okay? It's either pointing up or pointing down, right? And And before the particles start interacting, okay, before you assemble a larger collection of them, it doesn't care. Right? It doesn't care up or down, blue or white. Another, I think, more complicated order parameter that you might use if you're trying to use these theories to talk about the emergence, for example, of social power, right, is that individuals are unchanged by the shuffling of the social power that they have. Okay? And at some point, some hierarchy will emerge and break that symmetry. But in the earlier stage, that symmetry is preserved. Okay, so that's the order parameter. Then you have the control parameter. Okay, so the control parameter is an adjustable quantity in your system, right? You have a knob that you can turn. In general, the order parameter is the outcome of your simulation. Okay, but now you also have this knob, your control parameter that you turn, and that control parameter might be, for example, the strength of interaction. Okay? And again, I sort of listed order potentially of increasing abstraction, or decreasing abstraction, what your control parameter might describe. So it might describe, for example, how much you lose if you get the answer wrong in some joint decision-making process. Okay? And finally, the third concept is the concept of the critical line or the critical point. Okay? And so this arises from the notion of basis of attraction. And what you do is if you tune your control parameter correctly, if you set the knob just right, you sit on the borderline between two different basins of attraction. Okay? And in this lecture, we'll be concerned largely about what happens when you're very close to that critical point. Okay? So just to redraw the pictures of basins of attraction we had from before, okay, we talked about different mechanisms. So these ovals here circle different mechanisms, right? And this is the point in parameter space. Okay? And as you coarse grain that system, you flow into one basin versus another. This critical line here, okay, describes the division between these two basins of attraction. And we'll often be interested in systems that are sitting around this critical line. This sort of a mental sort of rearrangement you have to do, especially if your system is spatial, when you describe the order parameter. So imagine you have a bunch of agents, okay? So here's an agent, right? And that agent has an order parameter. In this case, the order parameter is a vector. So it's some vector, for example, describing preferences. It might be describing, you know, which direction you're looking in, right? And that order parameter is attached. Each guy gets one copy of the order parameter. It could be different. And you should think about all of those live in the order parameter space, right? So if all these vectors are the same length, for example, each of them lives, right, in this space here. And you can, in fact, draw, right? So this vector here, this agent here, is vector pointing in this direction. So you can put that agent's dot on the surface of the sphere there, corresponding where the vector is pointing. Okay? So that's the order parameter. We talked about symmetry breaking. Let me give you a simpler example. Okay, before we get to the dynamical symmetry breaking case, the spontaneous symmetry breaking case. Okay? So here's an example of essential symmetry breaking. And what I'm showing here is I'm showing the interaction matrix, okay, for two agents, okay? And the two agents can be in one of three states, okay? And you see here, right, the agents have an interaction where they get plus one if they're in the same state, right? So if they coordinate, so it's a game theoretic problem, if they coordinate, they both win, and they both win one. If they fail to coordinate, okay, then they get zero. So notice that it doesn't matter which action they coordinate on, okay? It's the same, they get the same payoff. And so this interaction here has a symmetry, okay? The symmetry is Z3, okay? Which just means the cyclic, or actually S3, which means all the permutations on three objects. And you know S3, we talked about it yesterday, and I've drawn a copy of S3 here, okay? So this is S3. So if you shuffle the labels of all the actions in all possible ways, okay, the underlying system is the same. Okay, so that's an essential symmetry of the system. Okay? You can imagine like a net logo simulation, and if you go and fill up the matrix, the payoff matrix, and shuffle it any way you like, you'll still get the same simulation on the other end. Okay? Now let's go in and alter this matrix. Okay? And what we'll do is we'll say, in fact, if you coordinate on the first action, you get a payoff that's higher. Okay? I've the symmetry. Okay? I've now broken the symmetry because if agents, play this action, they get a different payoff than if they play one of these two. And in fact, what I've done is I've broken now some of these shuffles no longer leave the system unchanged. Okay? And in fact, I've broken it from S3 down to Z2. Okay? So I still have a remnant symmetry. Notice that if I swap actions A and B or actions B and C, I still get the same answer, but I can no longer do the full shuffle. So that's an example, a very simple and somewhat laborious example of essential symmetry breaking. What I've done is I've gone in by hand and altered the underlying theory. Okay? Here's an example of symmetries being broken in a continuous case. Right? I begin with something that's extremely symmetric, a sphere. Right? And a sphere has symmetries O3. Okay? So what you should think about there is, say I take a sphere, right? You have a sphere in your dorm, right? And in the middle of the night, I sneak into your room and I rotate the sphere and I sneak out again. Okay? So you don't notice, right? Because the sphere is extremely symmetric. Okay? There's nothing, you can't tell I've done that operation. Okay? Now let's consider a sphere with latitude strong on it. Okay? By sneaking to your room at night, right, I now have to make sure that if I fill with your sphere, I can only rotate it around one axis. Right? I can only rotate it around the north-south pole axis. If I rotate it like this, you wake up and you see someone's messing with my sphere. Okay? So the symmetry, by drawing these lines, by making distinguishing marks on your system, you break the symmetry down from O3 to O2. And in fact, here, we actually break it even further. Now, if we also draw a line of two marks, right? Okay, I've now broken a continuous symmetry down to a discrete one. So I have to go in and be very careful and make sure I chunk and rotate it only by one unit, okay, for however finely you draw the line. Okay. Yes, Seth?
With the middle one, I can turn it all the way over, right? Is that discrete?
Yes. That's why I think it's, I should check, but that's why it's O2 instead of SO2. So I can also reflect it. But nice concept. So that's essential symmetry breaking. And what I've done there is I've put marks, I've changed my underlying theory. So I wouldn't say that's an inversion thing, right? Because I've gone into my net logo simulation and I twiddle it and I say, actually, guys, let's say action A gets your higher payoff. Right? So all I've done is I changed the underlying description. And yes, I'll get new phenomena at the higher level when I squint, right? When I kind of coarse grain and squint at it. But I've not really done anything new. The spontaneous case is much more interesting. And in the spontaneous case, and I'll show you a video in a second, maybe it will get to going to happen. In the spontaneous case, somehow the evolution of this system, for example, imagine ants crawling all over your sphere, right? Okay? And I distribute them randomly over the sphere, so yeah, maybe there's sort of clusters here and there, okay, but those are going to dissipate over time, right? So the ants are crawling all over the sphere. Sometimes the dynamics of that process lead to a violation of the underlying symmetry. Even though there's no special mark like, you know, sugar on top of the sphere, okay, the symmetry would violate spontaneously. So this is a wonderful film done actually by a group in Japan. So what they did is they had a big circular track and they put everyone in cars and they spaced them uniformly. Okay, and they said, okay, everyone drive safely. Okay, go ahead. And so they'll drive round and around in circles and there's a little bit of a lead in, so I'll talk you through it. So here they are driving around, right? This is, it's not a continuous symmetry, but it's a very high discrete symmetry, right? So if you rotate a chunk one car forward, the system looks the same, ignore the colors, Jeffrey would say. Okay? Okay? The environment here is symmetric, right? There's nothing exciting, it's not like there's anything to look at, right? Okay? But up. See, there's always a guy, right? Okay? And now we've broken this symmetry, we've broken that uniform lattice-like ring symmetry, okay, down to a lump. And that lump is over there. Now you can tell the difference between one side of the track and another. If I pause the movie, okay, and and rotate it, you can tell the difference. Okay? There, see? There it is. And in fact, not only is the symmetry broken, right? It's broken all the way down from Z22 or however many cards are there, right? So I can rotate it 22 discrete units. It's now broken to nothing, right? There's this lump. Okay, so again, just to give you the bedroom example, right? You have a photograph, right, of this system, okay? And I sneak in and I rotate it. Before the traffic jam forms, you have to I would say if the surface is rough in one place but not in another place, then that would be an example of essential symmetry breaking. Right? The experimenters have built in a preference for people slowing down here instead of over there. Right? If the surface was uniformly rough, then I would say that would be an example of spontaneous symmetry breaking. Right? It's uniformly rough, so if I go in and I rotate the whole track, you don't notice a difference. Right? And yet these traffic jams still form. So I think one of the questions here, just to go back, okay, so essential concepts, right? So what's the ordered parameter? Okay, so ordered parameter is a number that you attach to each agent in the system, okay, or a number or vector or matrix, or some mathematical object. Could be the velocity of cars, so it's a tricky question. Could be the velocity of cars, I think that's probably the right one, but I don't have a good answer. Actually, go back and read the Montreal paper on traffic that we had for the statistics question. This is my views in there. But I think it's something like spacing here between cars. And you start at the beginning, everyone has the same order parameter, right? Okay. By the end, the order parameter has changed. So I think that's the order parameter. But this is fuzzy. We'll get to the ones where we really strictly know the right answer. I think people have thought about this carefully enough yet to know. Okay.
Wouldn't you say that the density of cars along the track would be a very natural?
Yes.
So there's an order parameter because that increases and decreases as well. It's uniform in the beginning. It starts to be broken.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think that's also a previous suggestion of the distance between.
Oh, that's.
Yeah. Yeah. So like one over L, you know. Versus rho. So that's the order parameter potential. Next question, what is the control parameter?
Is it the driver's speed?
I think so. It could be the overall density of the track. Right? It could be the speed they're driving at. So presumably this would form more slowly if there weren't as many cars. We all know traffic jams are more common than the density of cars at the top. Right? So presumably the control parameter there is going to be something like total car density, not the density as a function of distance around the track, but just the overall density, how many cars are packing in. That's the control parameter, and what was the last one?
But the radius.
Sorry?
The radius of the...
Radius of the track could be important, right? So maybe you could fit the same density of cars if the turns weren't sharp, right? So those are the kinds of questions I think that one wants to ask if you're trying to examine what I would call sort of canonical, somewhat boring theory of traffic jams. Traffic jams are emergent, right? Nobody wants to be in a traffic jam. No one's trying to slow down and like cause all this sort of trouble, right? But somehow they emerge and they violate the underlying symmetry that was so carefully set up by these instruments. I'm very aware that we have an expert on turbulence in the room, so I'm going to try not to screw this up. So let me talk about symmetry breaking in a more sort of physical system, which is the system of fluid turbulence. Yes?
What the third concept that you're saying was turbulence.
Right. So it's a good question, right? So the idea would be the following, right? And I actually don't quite know how to draw the basis of the retraction here, right? One thing we don't know is how close we are to the critical point, right? We don't know if we decrease, let's say that the control parameter is the total number of cars, or the density of cars. So as we decrease that density, right? At some point, we'll get to a system that preserves the symmetry. We don't know how far away we are from that line dividing the systems that can go around in a circle and preserve the symmetry forever versus the systems that will spontaneously form clumps and fractures. And so we don't quite know how close we are to that critical point separating those two phases. So that's a short answer to your question. But you're right, that was a good question. So the Navier-Stokes equation governs fluid turbines. You have, in particular, I won't go through the whole thing, you have a control parameter here, nu, okay, which is viscosity. Actually, the control parameter will turn out to be a combination of nu with some aspects of the initial conditions. Okay? But here is a picture of smoke flowing around a cylinder at rather low speed. And what you can see the flow lines here. Right? So flow lines come in, they part to go around the cylinder, and they merge on the other side. Okay? And so this actually has a lot of symmetry, and I've drawn one example here, right? So if you flip this photograph, okay, and reverse the direction of time, we get the same flow field. Okay? Once we add in the additional term in the Navier-Stokes equation, this one here, okay, now we have an essential symmetry breaking moment, and what we can see is that symmetry is now broken. So now the fluid is flowing faster, so this term becomes relevant, so we now perceive it as fast. Okay? The flow is getting faster, and now this vector here is not simply the flip of that vector there. Okay? So as we increase the fluid flow, okay, we preserve something. For example, up to a critical point, we preserve this y symmetry. So even though we've broken the flip from here, here, okay, we still preserve this axisymmetric symmetry. Okay? But as we increase the flow even more and more, we get the formation of vortices like this. Okay? And so now this sort of beautiful mirror symmetry is broken. And in fact, just to give you a sense of the scale from which this theory applies, this is a cylinder sort of roughly an inch in diameter. Okay? This is actually a satellite photograph of wind vortices being formed off of a volcano. So on very different scales, you can use the same equation. What you find is the overall story is governed by this control term called the Reynolds number. Okay? And it's a combination of system dissipation nu, that term that goes into the Navier-Stokes equation, and also characteristic length scales and velocity scales of the system. So, for example, when we were talking about the control parameter of traffic, we also hypothesized that some L and V, right, some distance between cars, let's say, or some velocity, average velocity of cars is relevant to the control term. Here, it turns out that's the case, and also this other term, which is the dissipation, okay, viscosity. So, for example, molasses has a greater viscosity than water. Okay? So, in that case, if you try to make turbines in molasses, it would be harder. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show the cascading symmetry breaking that happens as the control parameters increase. It's a beautiful simulation that somebody did, where what you're going to have is you're going to have fluid flow, okay, around this barrier. Okay? And the control parameter will be slowly being increased. And what you'll see over time is various kinds of symmetries being broken one by one until in the end it becomes completely turbulent. Okay? So notice that the initial conditions are very symmetric, right? The water is coming uniformly in this direction. If you flip this upside down, it would look the same. So here we go. So at some point, this instability forms there. So now you get these vortex sheets show up. And in fact, as the velocity gets higher and higher, the vortex sheets get increasingly complicated from here. So there's a couple questions you want to ask. Okay. What's your symmetry? What's your order parameter? Okay. What's your interaction? Okay. And what's your control parameter? Okay. And that will tell you something.
What's the relation between symmetry breaking and
right, excellent question. So there's a very deep connection. And I don't have a full story, but many, many kinds of phase transitions, in particular the ones that are most known to physicists, the second order phase transitions, are always accompanied by a symmetry breaking. so what we'll do in a second is we'll look at the IC model, the classic example of the phase transition. Okay? Then the IC model first breaks the symmetry, breaks the up-down symmetry to either plus one or minus one. So there's very deep. Oftentimes, when you think about symmetry breaking, especially if you think about it in a thermal system, in thermal equilibrium, okay, you think about it not in the non-equilibrium phase, not in how the symmetry is broken, but just the fact that it is broken. Okay. What we're going to see in the next couple slides, and what I'll do is I'll show a simulation of this, is that if you break a symmetry and you break it too fast, people disagree about which way you broke it. So half the room says, oh, we've all decided that we have to pick either plus one or minus one, so we'll pick plus one. The other half of the room didn't get the message in time. Okay? And so they pick minus one. And that leads to the formation of something called a topological defect. Okay? So some half of the room, right, has settled on one state, the south state, another half of the room has settled on the bias state. Okay? And there's some boundary where catastrophic and exciting things happen. Okay. So I don't have to tell you what the IC model is if you've seen it. I should say that the IC model is not restricted to a lattice. Right? You can have all kinds of interactions. You can have them, for example, on a random graph. You can have them on some kind of social graph. Okay? But it's much easier to visualize the IC model when it's taking place on a lattice. Okay? So when the individuals are interacting with their neighbors, and the global structure of that interaction is a sort of beautiful pixel-like structure. Okay? So, what is your order parameter? Your order parameter is up or down. Okay. What is the symmetry? What we call Z2, right? So you can either be in the plus state or the minus state, or you can flip back and forth. Okay. And when you're isolated, it doesn't matter. Okay. What is your interaction? The pairwise interaction between neighbors on a lattice. What is your control parameter? Well, it's the temperature. So the temperature is a kind of noise, and what it's doing is it's telling you how much you care about your neighbor versus just fluctuating in response to your own issues. So let me pull up at the magnetization, which is the average of the order parameter, and it's fluctuating about zero. Okay? So if you multiply the order parameter by plus one or minus one, it stays the same. Okay? So as I lower this control parameter, okay, towards the critical temperature, okay, you see the islands of spin, the islands of choice getting larger. More coherent. You can see here, it looks like we have some islands of blue and a sea of white. Here, right to the critical temperature. Okay? We're slowly going through them. Yeah, there's always a couple guys that don't get the message till late. Okay? What's that guy doing? Who are you? Alright. That's probably the job I'm asking to visit. So, okay, what's happened here? Right? The magnetization is now peg at minus one, right? So everyone is in the minus one state, right? And compare the situation when it was up here. Okay? Up here people were flipping between plus one and minus one, so of course any particular photograph, okay, will look like a breaking symmetry. But statistically speaking, one configuration is as likely as the opposite configuration. So the symmetry is preserved, and then I go down and be very good at the blacksmith and cooling this thing down. And if it wants to be pedagogical, we'll hold off wait and say. But if you just talk about blue, okay, so I won't belabor the problem. Okay? So that's my control parameter. Now I'm gonna do something slightly different. I'm gonna go to the non-equilibrium system. Okay? So what that means is I'm going to change the control parameter very rapidly. Okay? So instead of slowly lowering it through the critical point, right? I'm just going to jump it down. Ha! Okay? That's a topological defect. It's actually two topological defects. And in fact, it's going to stabilize. Okay, now it's stuck for it. Okay? So, what is happening here? Okay? All these guys, they're all happy. All their neighbors are doing the same thing they're doing, and they all pick, in this case, a minus one state. All the guys here are really happy, right? They all picked a very good state as well. Right? They're all plus one, and they're all doing the same thing as their neighbors, so their cost function is optimized. Okay? These four guys here on the boundary, okay, of this defect called domain wall, okay, okay, are deeply dissatisfied, okay? They live in a state of constant tension, okay? Now, the reason that this domain wall is stabilized in this case is sort of artificial because we have this perfect symmetry here, right? So this guy says, you go blue, and I say, no, I'm surrounded by white guys. You go white, right? So if I can do this again, you can see, so sometimes it stabilizes like this. Other times, they just persist for a while. So, see if we can get one that persists for a while. How does this stay blue? Let's try one more time. And if not, then. So, above random, non-equilibrium, how? Okay. So this guy, I think, is going to disappear. Yeah. So what you had there was you had a bubble. Okay? A bubble. Here's the screen. Okay? Where these guys are all plus, and these guys are minus. But because the wall of this bubble had curvature, it almost like it has an effective surface tension. Okay? So a guy here, okay, he's minus. Okay? He has one, two, three neighbors that are plus, and only one neighbor that's minus. So it's in his best interest to switch to plus, but of course that puts a little dent in the bubble. And so the bubble will shrink. So there's an effective theory here, okay, the icing model, that looks a lot like a soap bubble theory, okay, as you cool it down. So that's a non-equilibrium topological defect. Do it one more time. So we had one bubble and it looks like one wall. It kind of goes all the way through the system. It's going to survive unless something drastic happens. So this is a state that, in, for example, mass N theory, is a zero probability. It's deeply unlikely. Okay? And yet it still persists. And why does it persist? It persists because we put the system in a non-equilibrium state. How do we put the system in a non-equilibrium state? We change the control parameter much more quickly than the natural time scales of the system. Okay? So, go back. Here's just a picture of the cosmologist. When I was a cosmologist, we were fascinated by them because we thought that if the universe began in a non-equilibrium state, you would actually have parts of the universe where everything was plus and parts of the universe where everything was minus, and now plus and minus find some of the underlying physical quantities of the universe. So electrons might be positively charged here and negatively charged here. Right? And there'd be some domain wall where just drastic and crazy things would happen. So. Let me talk about, and this is a beautiful example, it's also a rather theoretically sophisticated example. It's called the alpha roll problem, which I know Thomas talked about, but I'll just review all of it again, just so you know. But you know alpha roll is a bar in Santa Fe. We don't ask questions. Alpha roll is lots of fun. But this is invented by Brian Arthur. What I'll do is I'll talk about a version of the alpha roll problem called minority game just because it's simpler. Okay? But the basic story is the following, right? It's such a familiar problem, right? The problem is alpha roll had, I think, salsa nights, I think it's on Thursday, right? And salsa nights are great, okay, if there's a good crowd. Okay? But if the crowd's too big, you can't really dance, and it's just not so much fun, right? So it's the old paradox, it's too crowded, no one goes there anymore, right? And so, if the bar is too crowded, you'll stay home, and it's better to stay home, okay? If there's not so many people, then it's great, you have a wonderful time. And so, the problem is trying to figure out what everyone else is going to do, and kind of doing the opposite, right? So if you know everyone's going to go, right? If somebody says, oh, you had a whole summer school for an elf roll time, don't go, right? But, like, hey, you know, I think, like, not too many of us are going to go, that's great. So the question of whether the bar is good when it's completely empty makes the overall problem a little subtler. So you just simplify it, and you turn it into what's called a minority game. And the minority game says some people buy, and some people sell. So it's like, right, some people go to the salsa night, and some people stay home. Okay? And you always want to be in the minority. Okay? If the majority of people are selling, you win if you buy. Right, because it's buyer's market. If the majority of people are buying, you win if you're selling. It's the seller's market. Okay. And so the trick is, let's just say there's an odd number of people, so it's never ambiguous as to what the market is or the full player. So that's the minority game. And you can see, right, it has this like sort of inductive circularity, right? I know that last time I went, everyone went. So therefore, I'm not going to go. And someone else says, well, I know that last time I went, everyone went. And I know that Simon is not a really complex thinker. And so he'll probably not go. In fact, a lot of people go, well, go. Aha! Right? And then some other smart person comes in and says, well, you know, majority of people are thinking like, you know, Sanders, so I'll go one step ahead. Right? So there's this ratchet effect where everyone's trying to outcompete each other. So what's the limit state of that system? Right? I just hadn't thought about this problem in terms of being theoretic. You know, it's like, I know that you know that I know it. And there's no, it's a Kim James moment, right? Never mind. So how do you model this? Okay, one thing you could do is have a complicated psychological model and you try and calibrate what level people go to, what level K-thinking people do, right? And they might go to sort of level two, let's say. I forget, I know David Wolker has the knowledge of what level people actually think at. Level 2.1, what's the average level?
It's actually
1.57. 1.57. So if you can think of level two, you're well above average. So you can either get ahead by social complexity or intellectual complexity. Alright, so here is the wonderful story that people told, okay? And they said, I don't know how to tell a good theory about people's strategies, how people think about the world. Okay, I don't know how to model, I know you know, etc. Okay. And instead what I did is I consider the space of all possible strategies given a certain memory. And so here is a certain strategy given a memory, okay, of three. So the ones and the zeros here, zeros mean that the minority sold, and one means the minority bought, right? Because if you saw a zero last time, you would have won if you had also played zero, okay? So here's your memory. Your memory, in this case, this guy has a certain strategy. He says, if it was a buyer's market one, two, three times in the past, this time it's going to flip, and so it's going to be a seller's market, so I'll sell. Right? And then, okay, if it was a buyer's market, two steps in the past, the most recent one was a sell, then they'll probably go back. Right? So this truth table here encodes some bizarre narrative theory that somebody might have. Okay? Right? And here's another one, just to give another example. And so the way they model the system is as follows. I'm given two strategies, okay, that are drawn at random. So I've drawn this one at random from the space of all possible strategies with a certain memory. That's easier, just populate it with random numbers. Right? And then I have another strategy, okay, which I can populate with random numbers. And in general, these strategies are long enough, they'll be different. So I usually get results. Right? Okay. So that at each point in time, at the next step, I choose the pattern of thinking A or pattern of thinking B that has the highest cumulative payoff over the history of the game. Right? I can say, oh, I have one strategy that's, you know, I'll give it some funny long name because humans like to name, right? I'll give it the, you know, don't trust anyone strategy. And then the other one, I'll call it the, I remember actually I saw, I was checking my email on a friend's machine and he was like, he was investing in the stock market. And they have all these crazy theories about how the stock market works, right? So it's called the Elliott Wave Theory, or Elliott Waves. Seemed like the most pseudoscientific bookworm he had. So you have these two different crazy, totally nonsensical, totally superstitious theories about the stock market or the overall problem. Okay, and you just pick the one that works best the last time, or over the cumulative history of the system. Okay, so it's like you think you have a model, you think these models make sense, but secretly they don't. So what happens? Well, what you get, amazingly, is a phase transition in the system. So this was written up by a number of people, but in HLA is a description I'll talk about. I believe it was the first, but I don't want to get into the story because I don't actually know. So let's look at one parameter in the system. So this is neither a control parameter nor an order parameter. It's just something that's interesting, right? Just as in the traffic jam case, it'd be like how long it takes to get to work, okay? And what it is it's the variance of the payoff, okay? So what you're interested in, for example, say this is reinterpreted as a commons problem, okay? If 99% of people are trying to buy, only one seller wins. And that's kind of sad. So an optimal society, let us say, is one where somebody has to lose. It's the minority game, right? Somebody has to lose. But you want the minority to be as large as possible before it becomes a majority. Okay? You can also ask, what is the payoff of the commons? What is the average payoff of the system? Right? If people just chose randomly. And it turns out that it's n, where n is the number of players. Okay? So, it's hard to see this graph, I apologize. This top point here on this axis is plotted sigma squared over n. So this is the average payoff divided by the payoff you expect from the random. Okay? So this axis here is going to be our control parameter. Okay? And our control parameter in the traffic case is perhaps the spacing between cars. In the turbulence case is the ratio of length scales and velocity scales to viscosity scales. Here the control parameter is p over n. P is the number of strategies, or sorry, the number of histories you remember, okay, which is the log of the number of strategies. So P is equal to 2 to the n, where m is the number of steps you remember. Okay, so for example, in this case here, right, you remember 3 steps, okay, so there are 2 to the 3 possible histories you have to have a theory about. Okay? So 8 in this case. So P is 8. Right? And you divide by n, n is the number of players. How do you know that's the control parameter? Well, I think that's like if you're good at picking control parameters, then you know you write good papers. I don't know if there's a reliable method to pick them except for the intuition about what the important features of the system are. Okay, so if you pick something that's not a control parameter, don't feel bad. So what you see here is that when the memory is very low, okay, people actually do worse than if they were playing randomly. There are too few strategies. We have overlap, okay, in the number of strategies that we were able to access, right? So it's like we're all using Elliott wave theory, right? That means we're all in sync, right? We look at the same tree and we make the same decisions each time, and we just keep screwing them. Okay. And in fact, each time you screw up, say, oh, I hate Elliott wave theory, I really have to go with, like, I don't know, you know, Zodiac theory, right? And so everyone's got Elliott wave theory, fails, they go, oh, Zodiac theory, I fail, and they keep clicking back and forth. Okay? And they're doing actually much worse because of these herding effects, right? So everyone's running, ah, they're running, it's like the joke in the Economist cartoon. Everyone's running from the cell, ah, I fail, and Swiss theory to run over to the biomatch. So that's when the history is low, okay? When people don't have many theories because the baseline they can build their theories off is not very large. Okay? Over here, right, where the memory is very long, if you remember 10 steps, there are 2 to the 10 possible histories you have to have a theory about. And that means there's 2 to the 10, so 2 to the 1,000 potential theories about the stock market. Okay? In that case, everyone has a totally different theory, none of the theories overlap. And in fact, everyone looks like they're playing randomly. And so you converge in this average payoff, okay, to the random limit. Okay? The memory gets very large, we become totally unpredictable to each other. Okay? So even though our theories are very complicated, we just can't find a good one. Somewhere in between is a critical point. Okay? And showing a formula is a critical point is a whole set of mathematical problems. But you can see pictorially what's going on here. Is that actually we're able to have a lower, or to have a higher collective payoff. So the people in the minority are actually almost close to the majority. So what we've shown here, we've varied order parameter, and we've had a change in the system going from one state, okay, where people have really dumb theories, to another state where people have really sophisticated theories, somewhere in the middle, by preference for Elliott wave theory versus Zodiac theory. Okay? Because those theories were assigned to you at random when you began, okay, one should be no better than the other one. Right? The underlying structure of the system means that those theories are totally symmetric. How do I know they're symmetric? Because a poem I write randomly is as good as the next poem I write randomly. Right? Maybe by accident one will be slightly better than the other, but on average they won't. But what happens mysteriously past this critical point is that one theory actually becomes true, and that people rely on it more and more, okay, compared to the other theory. So you broke this control parameter here, okay, is, let's say, call strategy A0 and strategy B1. The control parameter, okay, is the average. It's an average number between 0 and 1. And it goes from being 0.5, okay, to being either 0 or 1. It breaks and falls one way or the other. So that's the hidden. Oh, a few minutes. Show you. theory, right? Libertarianism or whatever it is, right? Keynesianism, sorry, no politics, right? And then this is the ideal point, and then the symmetry breakages. So that's, I think, a beautiful example of an application of this notion of order parameter, symmetry breaking, and phase transition to a real social question. Okay? Now, you might ask, okay, if you're an economist who actually, you know, talks about real people as opposed to part of the demand strategy, you might ask, well, how does this actually vary given our a priori preferences for certain kinds of theories versus others? Okay? Even though our memory of the stock market is actually extremely long, right? We probably remember more than 10 years of returns on the stock market. Right? We certainly don't have 2 to the 2 to the 10 theories about the stock market floating around. Okay? And there's two ways to explain that. One is that we have internal preferences for one theory versus another. We have cognitive biases, okay? One theory. And notice in that case, all those possible symmetries are broken, essentially. Right? You stick in and you say, oh, you know what? Some of these are better than others just because of the structure of our neural system. Right? Another answer, which is somewhat mysterious, is that all these stupid theories about the stock market, right? All these stupid theories about it are emerging. Okay? The reason we all fall down on one versus the other, okay, is that we're in this part of the phase diagram. Okay? So if you re-ran the universe with the same neural structure for all the investors, okay, you would get a different set of stupid stock market theories. Okay? People would freeze on those instead of the others. Okay, does that make sense? Right? So the question is, what is the origin of economic behavior? And the case that's being made here is that it can actually be emergent. It doesn't have to be hard-coded in to a finite set of beliefs that each agent has. All right. Sarah, it says I've only spoken for 15 minutes, and that can't be true. No, okay. I have some time. Okay, yeah, I have half an hour. I don't think so. I don't think it's symmetry that's being broken.
If the portrait upside down.
Oh, that's a good one.
I would think.
Yeah.
So, and our numbers on the thing.
So let me tell you one more fun story. You can also, by the way, so let's imagine running that simulation there. Okay, so I have one more story about this. This is so much fun. Okay? Let's imagine you run this. Right? So this is all in equilibrium. Okay? Let's imagine you run this, and all stock brokers don't necessarily interact with each other. Right? There are some lags, okay? And you pass this critical point very quickly. You change the control parameter very quickly. Okay? What you can get is islands of different symmetries being broken. Okay? So you get topological defects. So that's the story I run at the top. So I'll walk past it very quickly and talk about a different kind of topological defect, just to give you a sense of the variety of phenomena you can see. So this is the story here, where the order parameter is actually not a number. So the order parameter we had in the alpha world problem we already gave was a number, simply IC model plus one minus one. In this case, let's make it a vector. Okay? The order parameter is a vector. I have to specify the interaction, okay, between vectors. And what I'll say is that vectors like to be aligned. Okay? So here, right, this guy is pretty much aligned with that guy, so he's feeling pretty good. Right? So now the question is what's going on here? Okay? Notice this configuration. Some guys are kind of unhappy. This guy and this guy are not perfectly aligned. Okay? And the same with these structures as well. Right? What's going on? What's going on is that try and unravel this little funny knot. Okay? And what you'll see is that in order to unravel that knot, right, in order to align all these guys, okay, so let's say you say, oh, this guy is bad, I'm going to turn it like this to make it happen. But now you violated this constraint and this constraint. So in fact, you have to go in and globally rearrange the whole vector field in order to undo these knots that have formed. Okay? In the same way, you have a big domain wall, so half your system is in the plus one state, and half your system is in the minus one state. You look at that wall, and you say, oh man, this is pretty simple, right? I just gotta get rid of the wall. Right? Well, how do I get rid of the wall? I have to get an entire half plane to all switch states. And that's gonna be a very hard case to make. Right? Similarly here, instead of a wall structure, you actually have a point structure. Okay? So this little defect here, these would not emerge, right? But they do, and when they do, they're very hard to get rid of. Okay? So this is called the XY model. It's called the XY model. Yeah.
Sir, but isn't the presence of such points or point structures or wall structures telling something about what's happening? Or?
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, no,
it's
great.
It's not always that we want to get rid of.
No. I'm just imagining some demon, and his job is to minimize the amount of points. I'm the devil's advocate in this case, right? And so when I say once, right, what I mean by once is that the equilibrium state of the system doesn't have these, right? Because these here are not optimal solutions, right? In the same way, let's redescribe the Ising model as like kind of the Bach versus Beethoven, right? Okay, except we both all want to go to the same constant, especially not even Bach versus Let's say we all have to agree. We go to this lecture hall, that lecture hall. And if we all pick the same lecture hall, then we win, right? If you have a topological defect, okay, that means half of us go to one lecture hall, half of us go to the other, but it's a fail, right? Here the fail is slightly more subtle, okay, but it's no less real for all the subtlety. To make a point, this symmetry breaking here is not really the emergence of this topological defect is not actually associated with phase transition. So there's a subtlety here. But it's still a beautiful example of a kind of internal structure that emerges, okay, because of the global constraints in the mind. So, let me pull up the XY model. And just as in the case with, just as you could build an effective theory for the domain walls that talked about their surface tension, actually, these little, so the green and the red are the two different kinds of defects. And one of the defects, the arrows are pointing away, and the other, they're pointing in sort of circular fashion. Right? And so, in fact, what you can see here is the defects are moving around. When a green one hits a blue, hits a red one, they annihilate, almost like particles. But of course, they're not real particles, just configurations of the field. Right? And not only that, there's even, kind of wonderfully, there's even a 1 over r attraction. So you have an emergent dynamics, okay? These little defects floating around in your system, okay? So again, just to be careful, this is a continuous phase transition, or this is a continuous phase transition, but that means that there's no transition in non-zero control parameters. So, let me just finish up by talking about this relationship, because this word comes up quite a bit. How do you go from a high temperature case, okay, where the control parameter means there's very low interactions, to the low temperature case? Okay? When you go between those two phases, okay, if you go slowly, okay, you'll break the symmetry in a reliable way, and everyone will pick the same value, okay, like in the Ising model, for example. If you go too fast, you get disagreements, and you get topological defects. In material science, this is used to build material with different properties. So if you anneal, that means you cool the system down very slowly, you get a certain kind of crystal structure when the iron is cooled. Okay? If you cool it very fast, if you quench it, you get lots of these defects. So you'll have a crystal structure here, but then slightly nearby you'll have a defect, so the crystal structure will be slightly dislocated. So you get lots of dislocation, finding lots of internal structure to the substance. And that actually can be quite good. It actually makes the structure harder. It's harder to snap it. Or it's harder to bend it, sorry. But when it bends, it does snap. So that's why when you see blacksmiths, they're hammering away on the anvil, right? And they take a hot piece of metal and they dump it in water. Okay? Because they want a non-equilibrium structure in their final bar of iron. Okay? And that has different properties.
To make sure.
Yes?
It's the transition from one state to the other which is fast. You end up in a kind of a equilibrium situation because it is resistant, it is static, it stays like that, so it is an equilibrium state. So the broken state itself can be equilibrium, yet the transition was out of equilibrium. That's kind of the point.
Let me sort of be careful not to distinguish it, right? So when the blacksmith takes his iron, his hot iron, dumps it in the water, the iron, if it had been cooled slowly, would have gone through a careful phase transition and come out the other end and be a uniform or quasi-uniform structure. He dumps it in the water really quickly, okay? Different parts of the iron don't have time to synchronize with each other. Some guys say, oh, my crystal planes are like this, the other guys say, my crystal planes are like that, and there's some disjunction there. Okay? Now, you cool it all the way down, and it's true. The system is now static, right? Except it's not in equilibrium. So on extremely long time scales, on extremely long time scales, it will decay. So you should be aware of the fact that a diamond is not an equilibrium configuration of carbon.
Okay, so then, but then it is important for me.
Yeah.
So extremely long scales.
Yeah, extremely long time scales.
Like that, it is not really. So it's made stable. It's made stability is of an incredible.
Exactly. It's an extremely long time scale thing. So diamonds will indeed. So diamonds are formed in very different conditions from where you were, right? Okay, so at room temperature pressure, your diamond will eventually, all the defects, right, will work out and you'll be left with a lump of graphite. Right? So, we've talked about universality at critical points. I won't go through this. I'll just put this up. I've had a wonderful time talking to you. So, here's all the slides in one. We began this whole sort of adventure. We talked about how to describe computation in terms of languages of behavior, right? And that allowed us to distinguish different kinds of languages, talk about languages certain systems could never produce. Right? And indeed, got a hierarchy, okay, or bestiary, the gym, of all the different computational powers that separate out the space of good and bad sense. Okay? We talked about a very simple class that were modeled by the finches. Okay? The simple class of finite state machines do not match parentheses. Okay? They also make terrible Bach feedback. Okay? Mm-hmm. And then we tried to apply this to a study of Wikipedia, and it's been really, I'm really grateful for the feedback and the argument we had about this project. It's a bit, but I started just to give you guys something give me something to do and a few guys can talk about. So I'm very grateful for that. Then we talked about statistics. We talked about the origin of entropy, why it's a magical function, and if anyone has a function that's different, it's actually just an approximation to the magical function. Okay? And we talked about not only how to use it to talk about information, the transmission of data across the wire, okay? But also how to use it to reason. We talked about how mass and prior, for example, or mass and entropy system, allows us, if we have the right constraints, to talk about the system without adding new inferences about what it should be. Okay? And not only that, we were able to derive thermodynamic principles from it. So we began with a set of epistemological claims and ended up with a set of thermal claims to talk about why steam engines work, and it's only serious. We talked about some practical things. We discovered that you guys do not seat yourselves according to gender or people, which is lovely. And the way we established that was that we looked at null models. Okay? And so what truly we established, we didn't have enough data to say whether or not we did. That's why I actually put my grant proposal a little more sophisticated method to detect sex and gender segregation. Then we talked about how to sample from a posterior distribution. We talked about Bayesian reasoning. Okay? We talked about how, if you want to know the probability of the model given the data, you can flip it and talk about the probability of the data given the model. But that data given the model probability can be hard to generate sometimes. So we talked about efficient ways to sample it and to figure out what the values of your parameters were. Okay? Finally, we got into this huge debate about how to do model selection. Okay? And I gave you an example called the Bayesian information criterion, which you can derive as a limiting case, okay, of the evidence ratio from David McKay's book. Okay? And we talked, just in case you thought that was a great idea and should be used by everyone, and anyone who doesn't use it as a bad person, we talked about how it deals with the metaphysics of dragons in your theory. And if all the dragons in your theory are asleep, okay, it doesn't hurt the theory. But that doesn't mean you should believe in dragons. That's not a good reason to believe in dragons. Okay? And finally, this is much more familiar, we talked about universality classes, we talked about coarse grain, okay, how to build effective theories. In addition, we talked about how the construction of effective theories on increasing scales might lead very, very different mechanisms, such as the mechanism not only for human language, but for computer language choice, to look the same, but even things like this manageable world. Okay? We talked about these as more interesting examples compared to the simple limit theorem. Okay? We took a detour through renormalization, which is what the physicists use because they know how to coarse grain their systems. They know that nearby things are friends, okay? And they're the most natural ways to aggregate. But you and I both know just because you're standing next to somebody doesn't mean they're a friend of yours. Okay? So how to coarse grain a biological or a social system is much harder. Okay? I presented a discussion, okay, about how to take a particular finite state machine, remember these guys, how to take a particular finite state machine and coarse grain the states into supergroups to produce a simplified machine. Okay? And then I showed, at least I made a claim, that didn't work in the case of liquid helium. So what that means is if you aggregate all of these people, okay, something magical happens, and the theory is no longer renormalizable, so when you coarse grain it, it no longer predicts the large scale institutional structure that you see in online social behavior. Finally, we come to the level. And this is a really fun example here of a lot of the concepts we've tossed around. I think it's also a wonderful example of how to attack, or one way to attack, a certain kind of problem that seems totally intractable. Right? It's like, how do we talk about all the stupid theories people have about their environment? Okay? Not how they build ideal theories, but how they build ones that are at least viable. And we talked about how the choice of those theories, given a certain complexity ratio, which is a control parameter led to symmetry breaking, and there are all sorts of beautiful phenomena that are described in that minority game paper. But thank you very much. I really appreciate it.